From downtown Toronto, our CBC Sports Digital Studio, this is a very different brunch, but I'm so glad to be joining all of you. Welcome, Huskie fans, friends, family, supporters. It is the 20th, can you believe it? The 20th annual, emphasis on virtual, Huskie Women's Basketball Brunch. And as you can tell, this year looks a little bit different. Of course, I wish I was in a room, in a hotel room, downtown Saskatoon, looking across the room, looking at all of you. But imagine me looking at all of you, probably in your pajamas, in your homes in Saskatoon. It is such a pleasure to be joining all of you. Devin Haru, a reporter with CBC Sports. I've had the great pleasure of hosting a number of these brunches. And here we go again, a career first, hosting a brunch in a pandemic. And here we are. Like I said, a pleasure to be joining all of you. We should get right to it. And let's talk about the fact that a lot is different, but a lot remains the same. And that, of course, is the support of Ron and Jane Graham, who have been supporters of Huskie Athletics and the women's basketball program for many, many years. And we are very, very fortunate to have them here tuning in with us today. And once again, they're making a very generous offer, and as always, they're challenging us, challenging all of you watching from wherever you are today. The Grahams will be matching all donations made today. And all you have to do is click on the link somewhere down here or go to huskies.usask.ca. You can do it right now while you're listening to me ramble, clicking on the Donate Now tab. Be sure to designate your gift to the Huskie Women's Basketball program. As always, thank you, Ron and Jane Graham, for your incredible generosity and continued support of the Huskies women's basketball program. Now, I don't need to tell you what happened in March. It was what? March 12th, when the world stopped. But just days earlier, rewind the clock and let's bask in it for a moment. On March 8th, one of the last championships in the world that was won by the Huskies women's basketball team. Who can forget that day? March 8th, it's actually my dad's birthday, so I can't forget it. I was at the Briar in Kingston, split screen, basketball, curling, and of course, our women winning the national title for a second time. Let's watch this video, this team's one shining moment.
Tipped. There you are. You're running for your life. You're a shooting star. All those years, no one knows. Just how hard you work.
Back out. Quick hit for three. Ducati again. Tray number eight on the ball game for Sabina Ducati.
You reached deep inside in one shining moment.
There's one shade of gold in Saskatchewan in the form of wheat sheaves. Now there's another in the form of a gold medal. The Saskatchewan Huskies are the 2020 U Sports Women's Basketball National Champions.
Your best, 'cause inside you knew that one shining moment you will return. One shining moment you knew. One shining moment.
beautiful to watch them hoist the bronze baby in Ottawa, the second national title. And can you believe it? I'm going to introduce two key members of that championship squad, Megan Ahlstrom and Sabine Ducati. Start their career winning the first national title, win their second title, going out into the sunset, going out on top. So let's talk about these two for a quick second. Megan played 5 years for the team. She studied kinesiology and is currently doing her master's in physiotherapy at the U of S, currently living in Calgary, but she's running back to Saskatoon, like we all do, in January. Now, Sabine also played from 2015 to 2020 while studying psychology. She hopes to graduate this spring, currently working and coaching basketball in Saskatoon, always giving back to community while she finishes her degree. Let's hear from the two of them right now.
So just a little bit from our past season, I think that we just had a super good energy about us. From the previous season, we fixed a lot of the things I think that we needed to, and a lot of that was off the court. We just started to have more fun in practices, and I think that really started to translate into our games throughout the season.
Yeah, having a lot of players staying in Saskatoon past summer made a big difference because we had a chance to keep improving our weaknesses from the last season. And I think that made a big difference to our game, how we played together as a team and individually.
Yeah, and just a little bit about our playoff run and our experience at Nationals. It kind of seems so long ago now, but having the chance to play that last game at home was huge for us. We were lower in the rankings and we weren't supposed to host. So for me and Sabine and Vera, we didn't think that we'd have another chance to play at home. And we got that last game there, and that was big to be able to win Can West at home one more time. Was really special for all of us. And for Nationals, I don't even think we actually openly talked about, you know, winning Nationals and coming first. It was kind of just like a really calm confidence about us. That's just kind of what we expected of ourselves all season, and that's what we were there to do. And then at Nationals, we honestly just played our best when we needed to. We really truly peaked, and I think everyone played their best games while we were there.
Yeah, and as Megan already mentioned, finishing in Canvas final at home was the best outcome for our team and great honor for us as a fifth years. And I think a lot of players are still frustrated from our previous season and last Nationals. So we knew what it takes to be in Nationals and how good we have to perform and play together as a team and have fun out there.
Yeah, I think there were like a lot of nerves when we were there, but it was just like a really calm energy about us. I know that we talked individually about kind of the things that we wanted to achieve while we were there. And for us 50ers, it was kind of just to have the most fun that we possibly could. And obviously winning was kind of the icing on top of that. So about the final game, though, I know I was super emotional after it because it truly took us 5 more years to get back to that stage. And we knew the kind of hard work that we put into it. And for me and Beans being there in first year and then there again, it was two totally different energies, but it was amazing. And I still get kind of emotional and get chills when I think of it.
Yeah, I think it was awesome to see that we were all on the same page. And before the game, even we all just like knew that we all have to go out and play our best game and just have fun. And as the 50ers, it was a great honor to be back on the final stage and win the U Sports National Gold. And now I will pass it along to Libby and Summer. They'll talk a bit about this season, 2020, and how it is to not have games and just practice.
Thanks, Megan and Beans. It really seems like yesterday we were all in Ottawa. It's crazy to think how much the world has changed since then. I mean, we were celebrating a big win. We came home and then it really felt like reality hit. We didn't really get a chance to celebrate with our fans or have, you know, that period of kind of our fairy tale story. So I think that was really difficult. And then the big move to having school online and everything was even a huge change. Of course, we had our Huskie Athletic Council awards canceled, which was tough. I know the fifth year athletes for all sports really found that difficult. And I think going into the summer, it was a weird time of, we're not even training, like we're not even practicing. We haven't seen each other in weeks, especially after being together for so long. So that was a really weird period of time. And there was just a lot of confusion about even the upcoming season. So I think during the summer, it was important just to be really grateful that we got in that championship before the world shut down. And looking back, I think it made it even more memorable to be like, look at what we accomplished in this crazy time. And we were so lucky to be together for that. And everyone was safe and healthy. And I think it just made it more special. And to have that ring and obviously shirts and merchandise and stuff that shows that is incredible. And looking back on this year through the ups and downs, like we'll always have that good time to look back on.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so I guess over quarantine, we were able to Zoom each other as a team a few times, and we had talked about, okay, we want to get back together in September. We want to be together on as a team and lean on each other during these difficult times. So ever since September, we've been kind of practicing three times a week. And during that time, we are just working on getting better. I think the biggest thing we've talked about is that this is a time where we can really hone in on some skills and get better as a team. And not only on the court, but that kind of team chemistry element too. Like, we do have some new rookies this year, and this is a really great opportunity to integrate them into the team and get closer as a team as well. Even though it is hard with the restrictions of COVID, we are trying to make the best of it and staying positive. And we're so thankful that we have all of you guys to support us. And we're so happy we get to have a virtual brunch. So we just want to roll you off to the next video, which is an introduction to our team that Connor made for us that features our family members, which is really special. So thank you.
She's number one on the program. She's number one in your hearts. She's your national champion, floor general, hailing from Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, Libby Epic!
Six-foot guard from Calgary, Alberta, where she works with trees and shoots threes.
Number three.
Of Prince Albert,
standing 5'8" tall.
In her first year playing basketball for the University of Saskatchewan Huskies.
Number 5,
Grace Grosser!
Ladies and gentlemen,
from Saskatoon, number 6, Katriana Filipenko!
Introducing our daughter
and our sister,
second year guard,
number 7, and Andrea.
And my not so little sister
and her two best friends.
My go-to for getting things off the top shelf.
6'3", number 8, from Saskatoon, Saskatchewan.
Kyla Shand.
Introducing number 9, from Lisbon, Portugal, Claudia Viana. Yay!
Let's get ready to rumble! At forward, in her fifth year, from Calgary, Alberta, number 11, Summer Maskowitz!
Introducing number 12, from Calgary, Alberta,
our favorite Saskatchewan Husky,
Erin Carrig.
It is our honor and privilege
to introduce, from Warman, Saskatchewan, fifth year, number 13, Janaea Brown.
Hi, Husky Nation. Introducing at power forward from Saskatoon, Courtney Primo.
Introducing from Moose Jaw, 5'10" forward,
Anna Velda.
Go Huskies!
From Saskatoon, by way of Aiden Bowman Collegiate, standing at a burly 135 pounds and exactly one beanpole tall,
a master of the practice squad and a tactician on both ends of the court, it's Tegan. No, Connor couldn't make it today. Dirksen!
From Saskatoon!
Let's get you.
Fifth year senior.
CJ 710. Connor J.
Connor J.
Go, Husky!
Go!
Introducing the fearless leader of the Big Bigs from Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, assistant coach with the Huskies, Allie Cat Fairbrother!
From Saskatoon, Saskatchewan,
assistant coach for the Huskies team for 17 years,
my best friend,
my godmother,
Angie Jeffy!
Go Huskies!
And from the booming metropolis of Brantford, Ontario,
home of the great ones like Wayne Gretzky, Alexander Graham Bell, and
Claire Meadows.
What's up, Husky Nation? Making a special introduction, the Canadian coaching goat.
From Dundas, Ontario.
A two-time. Yes, you heard that correct. A two-time national champion. The Canadian Senior Women's National Team head coach.
In her 23rd season with the Huskies.
Longer than I've been playing basketball. As the Huskies head coach, give it up for...
Head coach, Lisa Tomaitis.
Lisa Tomaitis.
Go Huskies, go!
Go Huskies!
Go Huskies, go!
Go Huskies!
Thank you, Sabine, and thank you, Megan, and congratulations once again to the entire squad. Two national titles, just elevating this women's basketball program to a completely different level. So this is a part of the program where my script gets to say I get to ramble a little bit. So I apologize to all of you because I am going to ramble a little bit. I was asked to talk about what this time has been like as a sports reporter in a pandemic when I don't have to tell you not a lot of sports are happening. So this has been a fascinating thing for me because for those of you who may know me and for those of you who don't know me, one of the things about me is I love to be on the road. And over the last number of years as a CBC News and CBC Sports reporter. I've had the great pleasure of traveling all around the world, anywhere from 8 to 10 months out of the year, and tell sports stories, and have a front row seat to some of the best athletic moments in this country and around the world. And then, and this will get to the bigger theme that I want to talk about, is what do we do when the bright lights of the world are turned off, when the stadium and arena doors are closed, and when in the darkness of our rooms, we're sitting there and we're having to reflect about who we are when we're not on the stage that brings out the best in us. And for me, this has been quite a journey over the last 8-9 months. I had a lot of ideas about what I thought 2020 was going to bring for my career, including leading a lot of our coverage on the ground in Tokyo for not only the Summer Olympics, but staying for the Paralympics. And so when I reflect on all of this, it's certainly been challenging at times to wake up every morning and feel like this is a perpetual Groundhog Day and look at the mirror and tell myself stories about who I am and what I want to do and what I'm not doing. One of the things that I've heard a lot of and that I personally have felt a little bit uncomfortable about is sort of mourning the losses in my life, the losses of not going to the Olympics, the losses of not traveling around from city to city, running around, drinking coffee, sharing stories. Because I think, and this will get back to athletes and what I think a lot of athletes are feeling, is we certainly know that in the midst of the pandemic, that health and safety is the utmost important. We know that lives have been lost tragically, and we know that there are very serious things happening in the world right now. And what has become clear, I think, to a lot of us is that sport has always been this sweet escape, either for athletes, coaches, assistant coaches, physiotherapists, or fans, where on Friday and Saturday nights and maybe other nights of the week, we get to kick back and crack a cold one and sort of slide into an abyss of unscripted sports that play out on our televisions. And we haven't had that distraction. And athletes haven't been able to go and train in the way they're used to. And we're so singularly focused sometimes on reaching a result or knowing where the finish line is. And both in life and in sport, in the midst of this pandemic, there is no finish line to all of this. And so one of the great gifts about my job, because I was never good enough to be an elite athlete, so I figured I'd just ride their coattails and share their stories. But one of the things that becomes evident in my career and my work is that I get this great gift of perspective, the perspective of Olympians and high performance athletes, the perspective of sports psychologists. And what I've been hearing more and more and more is that this is a remarkable time for us to embrace the unknown. And I think there's so many parallels between life and sport and all of this. Things are gonna go wrong in a basketball game. Things have gone wrong in the midst of life and in the midst of this pandemic. And our real character comes through in these moments of uncertainty and in these moments that are so at times scary and unknown. And so I've been sitting with that. I think there's been a lot of personal growth for me in understanding my role in all of this, the type of story I want to be, showing up with compassion, patience, and empathy in a way I've maybe never achieved in my career. And so perhaps as I get to introducing our remarkable head coach, Lisa Tomaitis, I would just say that I hope that you and yours are staying safe and healthy throughout all of this, that you're looking after your mental health. I know that is, for me right now, the utmost importance as we go into the holiday season as well. This can be a dark and isolating time. And so know that on this morning, it is beautiful to be with all of you, to understand that collectively, we might all be struggling, but we're all in this together. And so now I shift gears to our head coach, Lisa Tomaitis, whom I've had the great pleasure of getting to know both as a coach and who I like to consider a great friend in my life, someone who has always embraced the unknown, somebody whom I've watched as a journalist and as a friend suffer through some heartbreaking losses and have to look inward about her role within all of that and how she can move forward and how she can bring out the best in people. It is an incredible skill. It is an incredible characteristic. And I think we are massively, massively lucky to have someone the likes of Coach Lisa Tomaitis be leading this women's basketball team at the University of Saskatchewan and, of course, be leading the national women's basketball team. I cannot wait to be chronicling your success, Coach, in Tokyo. For now, we'll continue to ride the wave together. And for right now, I'll turn it over to you for some always thoughtful words from the coach, Lisa Tomaitis.
Okay, good morning, everyone. Thanks so much for joining us this morning. This is the part in the program where you dread coming after Devin Haru in the agenda. But thank you so much, Devin, for the introduction. Always great to hear from you. Your messaging is just so appropriate and just so great to have you lending your star power. Again, welcome. COVID may be keeping us from getting together like we usually do for our brunch, but we didn't want it to keep us from connecting with you and really from celebrating last year's successes as well. And that is the purpose for this morning and our virtual brunch, to stay engaged with our supporters and families, celebrate last year's successes, introduce this year's team, as well as provide a bit of an update on what we've been doing up till now this year. I know you've heard and seen a bit about our championship run, but I wanted to share some of my thoughts on what was a truly remarkable experience with some amazing women. So first of all, here's what everyone in women's basketball in Canada dreams about and works so hard for. So over my right shoulder, hopefully you can see, that is the Canada West Trophy. And we won that last year, and thankfully the U of S name is on that trophy 7 times, which we're super proud of. And next, over my left shoulder, is the coveted bronze baby. Represents the pinnacle of university basketball in this country. And, you know, it's just absolute dream come true to be able to bring both of those trophies home to Saskatoon last year. Maybe the way things are going, obviously we're gonna hold on to this for another year coming, so that's pretty cool. It's been sitting in my basement ever since March, ever since we got back from Nationals. But just wanted to take a moment right now to acknowledge all of the people who've contributed over the years to make this happen. You know, these achievements don't happen without all of the support and backing from you, our supporters, our family, our staff, our alumni, our community, and our university. It may sound cliche, but these championships are not just for us, they're for all of us, because so many people have contributed to that and to have made this possible. So a little bit about our championship run last year. You know, first of all, we had a team that had its eyes on this championship from day one. We knew what it was going to take, and everyone was bought into the process right from the get-go. Heading into Nationals at Ottawa last year, you know, we knew that the participating teams would be the toughest competition that we've likely ever faced. But by that Sunday night, it became clear to everyone who watched that our team was the class of the competition. And really what I was most proud of was how we won and how we competed. I thought our team played with heart, determination, and amazing chemistry. And as much as we had the pressure of being the number one ranked team in the tournament, we played with composure and confidence. We won together and we won with class. And you know, after the tournament, I had several strangers reach out to me. It was crazy. They emailed me or texted me and got in touch. And, you know, they were just impressed. They wanted to express how impressed they were by our skill level and style of play. But more importantly, they were impressed by how our players conducted themselves with opponents, officials, fans. And as a coach, it's those comments that really make me proud. So we were very thankful for the families and friends and supporters that came to Ottawa to experience our utter jubilation, and also appreciative of everyone who watched and cheered from afar. You know, being on CBC was amazing. For people to be able to tune in from coast to coast and watch this happen was truly remarkable and very, very special. But before I go on, I just have a quick story from Nationals. Immediately after the championship game, you know, we celebrate, we're taking the pictures and end up going back and doing some media stuff. But when I come back out onto the court to see everyone, one of the first people I see is Ron Graham. And the first thing he says to me is, "Order the rings." And so I wanted to take a moment to show everyone what the rings look like. And these are compliments of Ron and Jane. And so here they are. I don't know if you can see them, but there's the S. There's a lot of bling, as requested by the players, has the score of the game, the U Sport logo, and obviously the Huskie S. And right now we're just working on finding a way to get these presented in an appropriate way in the future. So our players don't even have them yet. So what has happened since that magical weekend? Well, like everyone else, our world has been turned upside down. And literally 1 week after we returned from Ottawa, we were told we needed to vacate the Ron and Jane basketball training facility. Merlis Belcher was turned into a field hospital. So despite our excitement last year around moving into our own practice facility, we're now somewhat homeless, you know, and it was so exciting, you know, last season to finally get moved into that practice facility. It was just an amazing place to be training. But now the excitement was short-lived because now, like I said, we're basically homeless. We went from March to September without seeing each other face-to-face, without picking up a basketball, without training together. We really had nothing. But thankfully, by September, we were able to resume training. And, you know, having said that, it really doesn't look anything like it did last year when we were together. We don't have access to a team room or an office and can only access the pack through a loading dock in order to maintain COVID protocols that allow us to train. But instead of focusing on what we don't have, we're choosing to focus on what we do have and what we are thankful for. So despite our season being canceled, we do have 13 student athletes who have committed to doing whatever we can to keep growing and improving as a team. Our players have come back to Saskatoon from across the country, and in Claudia's case, all the way from Portugal, because they want to be with their teammates and they want to keep working with one another to get better. So for that, again, we're grateful. It's pretty amazing to be able to get together with them every day, or at least on a consistent basis. So just a little bit about our new players. Again, I know that they've been introduced by their families, but just wanted to take a moment to say a little bit more about them. We have four new players this year who we're excited about. First one is Gage Grasik. So she's a guard out of Prince Albert who's going to be very good. You know, she's like an energizer bunny. I think people are going to have a good time watching her, going to really enjoy watching her play. She competes hard and she's really picking things up like a sponge. She's learning lots from Libby Epic and our other veterans. Anna Melda joins our crew from Moose Jaw Peacock. She's a talented, hardworking athlete who has a great first step and can get to the hoop. So we're looking forward to seeing her out there. Courtney Primo is the daughter of Heather Stalwick, and Heather played for the Huskies in the 90s, so some of you will remember her. Courtney's a 6 foot forward who has a solid basketball IQ and can shoot the ball with 3-point range already. Last but not least is Taya DeMong, and she's from Hinton, Alberta, who most recently was named Miss Basketball Alberta for 2020. And interestingly enough, Taya is the fourth Husky recruit to be named Miss Basketball Alberta in the history of our program. The other three were Ashley Duchak, Megan Alstrom, and Carly Alstrom. So she's certainly following in some pretty big footsteps. Taya is a 6 foot guard who competes hard, has lots of personality, and again, looking forward to seeing her in a Husky uniform next year. I think she's gonna make an impact right away. So as far as what we've been doing this fall, as I said, we've been able to train consistently since September. And unlike many other teams across the country, we've been able to compete against one another. So that's really been a gift. We've been able to maintain our strength and conditioning workouts. We've also had the opportunity to do some team activities away from the court. So in October, for example, we did our annual run for the cure. We did it kind of virtually. We were able to still raise $2,000 for the Canadian Cancer Society. We took the team horseback riding, and that was the first time on a horse for a few of our players. So that was lots of fun. That was a great experience. It was a beautiful day. We got outside. And we've also done a few team walks in the fall just to experience some of the beauty that Saskatoon and the Mewawson Valley have to offer, you know, especially considering we have quite a few players from outside Saskatoon. So we wanted to be able to expose them to that. And we also took the opportunity to engage with our alumni base. So we started an alumni speaker series, which actually took place every Sunday evening through the month of November. And that was a lot of fun. Again, just hearing from our alumni and listening to some of their stories and some of the lessons that they learned along the way and them taking the time to share that with our current athletes was much appreciated. So from a financial perspective, you know, the university and our team have taken a pretty big hit. And much like many other organizations, businesses and individuals right now, you know, we know that we're not unique. You know, our budgets were cut due to COVID, and then the impact was kind of compounded by not being able to run our two big annual fundraisers in the same ways that we typically do. So that's just the reality of the situation. So You know, despite this reality and the uncertainty around whether we would have a season, we knew we needed to continue to support our student athletes in any way we could. So we made the decision back in the spring that we would honor our scholarship commitments to all of our student athletes. We just felt that that was necessary, and we needed to convey that to them back in May. So faced with this financial reality, we wanted to do what we could to be part of the solution to this unfortunate situation. You know, we didn't want to sit back and just, you know, feel badly for ourselves. We wanted to kind of take the bull by the horns here. So we did a couple of things to help out. First of all, we were lucky enough to have an opportunity for our players to work the provincial election. And what we did was the money that they made is actually being put back into our program to help offset some of our expenses this year. So I thought that was a really great step on our athletes' part. And the other thing is we actually decreased our scholarship payouts by 10% this season to each of our student athletes. Now, having said that, we still gave out over $50,000 in scholarships this season. And really the only reason that this was possible is due to the generosity of our supporters and donors. Otherwise it wouldn't have been possible. And I'm not too sure, you know, what we would have done if we didn't have that money. Again, unique to our place is every dollar that is given out to our student athletes has been fundraised and donated by individuals. You know, something we certainly never take for granted or lose sight of. And it's because of that generosity that we are able to provide that support to our student athletes during this difficult time. So again, I think it's really important that we acknowledge that and recognize that and that our student athletes do know that and understand where the money is coming from. So as of Friday, you know, our team practices and training have actually been paused now due to the provincial government health restrictions that were just announced. So as much as we were excited about being able to train through the fall, we're now put on pause. We're hopeful that we'll be able to resume some training in January, February, and until the end of our natural season, which would have been into March. But like everything, we have no way to predict what our next few months will look like. We're going to remain optimistic and really can't wait to get back on the court doing what we all love to do. And that's really what we're hoping for. And again, know that there's no way to predict when that may be, but we certainly are missing being out on the pack, on the court, in front of all of our fans and supporters. So just in closing, I just have a few thank yous for sure to do. First off, I want to thank Ron and Jane Graham, who continue to support the Brunch and our team in such a transformative way. As I showed, the rings are also from them. So it's just, their support's just been massive and has really goes a long way with our team and with our program and where it has been able to go and the accomplishments that we have been able to reach. Also want to give a shout out to Melanie Ricacci, who also recently stepped up to support our program in a big way. So that was very much appreciated, especially in this time. Big thanks going out to Connor Jay for making the amazing videos that were shown today that you're able to see. You know, I never tire of watching them, that's for sure. They really capture some amazing moments, and he just certainly has a gift for putting those together. Also want to thank Kara Lackey and the Huskie Women's Basketball Foundation for making this happen today, and continuing to think outside the box to stay engaged with our most loyal supporters. You know, I didn't know that this would even be possible, and so for her to be able to have this idea and bring it to fruition is very much appreciated on behalf of our entire team. And Devin, Haru, thanks for lending your star power and being such a great host for our Brunch year after year. You really make it special, and again, your messaging was really on point today, so thanks to you, Dev. Last but not least, everyone who's tuning in today, we're so thankful for the support we receive from this community. It's this support that truly separates us from all other programs across this country. Can't thank you enough. Can't thank you enough for tuning in and for, again, just backing this program the way you have over the years. We hope to see you before too long, you know. Just to everyone, stay well. Hopefully we see you before too long. And on that note, I'll turn it back over to Devin to wrap things up.
Coach, thank you for those thoughtful words. You continue to inspire. And like I said, no, I can't wait to be in Tokyo this upcoming summer, where we'll be back to the court and playing sports. Fingers crossed. That's it. That is a wrap on this virtual Brunch. Thank you for tuning in, Huskie family. You heard from Lisa. The team is working extraordinarily hard during this unique, they're going to call it unique, I would probably call it a different word, but unique season, to make sure this team continues to operate at the highest level, no doubt remaining the cream of the crop when it comes to women's basketball in this country. On behalf of Lisa, her team, everyone behind the scenes who make Huskie basketball what it is, I'd like you to consider one last time, I'm going to give you a last poke here if you're able to make a donation to the women's basketball program. Remember, Ron and Jane Graham are matching donations made to the women's basketball program today, huskies.usas.ca. Together, I think that's the important takeaway from this morning. Together, we can ensure our team emerges from this year stronger than ever, remains the top of its class in our country for years to come. Thanks for taking some time to join me from our broadcast center in downtown Toronto. I'm wishing all of you, like I said, all the health and safety in the world. We're all in this together, and I appreciate you tuning in today. Stay safe. Can't wait to see you all again in person very, very soon.